my years of public life, I have never obstructed justice. And I think, too, that I can say that in my years of public life, that I welcome this kind of examination, because people have got to know whether or not their president's a crook. Well, I'm not a crook.
To share with you what the United States knows about Iraq's weapons of mass destruction. Every statement I make today is backed up by sources, solid sources. These are not assertions. What we're giving you are facts and conclusions based on solid intelligence.
So what I wanted to see is if you could give me a yes or no answer to the question, does the NSA collect any type of data at all on millions or hundreds of millions of Americans?
No, sir.
It does not.
Not wittingly.
You have to get rid of this ignorant and meddlesome majority. Control them, make sure they do the right things, all for their own good, incidentally. If they're allowed to participate, they'll make all kinds of mistakes and errors, but we, the responsible men, we know how to do the right thing, like get into the Vietnam War, invade Iraq, and deregulate the banks so that everything crashes. We get everything straight.
My fellow citizens, at this hour, American and coalition forces are in the early stages of military operations to disarm Iraq, to free its people, and to defend the world from grave danger.
I believe very deeply in freedom of the press and the role of the press in a free society. And I have ever since I was a kid. You can't fulfill your function unless you're free.
One of the great reporters of the 20th century, I.F. Stone, told journalism students never to forget that all governments lie. He could speak with authority, having spent 7 decades exposing deception and official lies by digging deep into government documents and transcripts.
I tried to prove what I was saying from the horse's mouth, as it were, using the government's own documents, government reports and transcripts and press conferences and speeches, and analyzing them the way a historian would.
He gained his greatest fame and impact publishing the newsletter called I.F. Stone's Weekly.
Everybody in government and journalism knew Izzy Stone and read his stuff.
But I.F. Stone's Weekly is about this size.
Well, I.F. Stone's Weekly was a classic example of an independent journalistic organization that was able to report the truth. And that's the way alternative media, which I really think is real journalism, has always worked, as a vehicle that has exposed the collusion, hypocrisy and lies of the commercial media.
Do you presume to criticize the great Oz, you ungrateful creatures?
I mean, Stone was kind of like Toto. You know, it was like his job was to pull back the curtain.
The great Oz has spoken.
Oh.
Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain.
And to see what was behind that curtain. And what was behind that curtain, yes, it was the all-powerful Oz, but it was also just a frightened little man. Nothing that any of us need to be frightened of. And why are we frightened of that? That's the embodiment of what he and his weekly stood for, and it certainly was a huge inspiration to me.
Surveillance of certain mosques, okay? I watched in Jersey City, New Jersey, where thousands and thousands of people were cheering as that building was coming down. Donald J. Trump is calling for a total and complete shutdown of Muslims entering the United States until our country's representatives can figure out what the hell is going on. You have no choice.
Who would have thought that this circus would come to town? But, you know, it may not be good for America, but it's damn good for CBS. That's all I got to say. The money's rolling in, and this is fun. I've never seen anything like this. And, you know, this is going to be a very good year for us. It's a terrible thing to say, but bring it on, Donald. Go ahead. Keep going.
It makes you ask, seriously, whether those executives who run media conglomerates have any more ethics or morals than those who run the oil and gas industry, the pharmaceutical companies, the tobacco industry. It's an open question to me.
Driving my limousine. Now it's all designed to blow our minds, but our minds won't really be blown.
We're in New Hampshire, which is like the capital of depressed America, where, you know, the manufacturing economy has disappeared, and we really don't examine those issues at all. We don't actually talk to people at all, because you don't have time. There's only time to watch the speech, to ask the people in the audience what they think of the speech, and then you go on and you move on to the next spot. The entire thing could be shot in a soundstage in LA with just by rotating in a different audience each time.
Well, Donald Trump, of course, remains the strong frontrunner up here to win the Republican primary in New Hampshire tomorrow. It snows in New Hampshire. People know how to get cars. They got used to put chains on. Now they got good tires. Why should they trudge through the snow for Donald Trump?
Well, you know, my whole concept and my whole theme, frankly, behind it is make America great again.
Make America great again. We're going to make America great again. We're going to make America great again. Build a wall. Build a wall.
I'm very focused on the idea that these voters have completely shifted their tune about what they're upset about. But, you know, there's a lot of subtleties that people in this kind of audience don't pick up on. And he's smart enough to know that he can just steamroll right past a lot of those problems and not going to be noticed by anybody.
Thank you very much, everybody. Wow, this is beautiful.
What do you like about him? He's
going to be his own man. He's proving that right now, how he commands the media. Paying nothing, and he's getting all media coverage.
So you think that's part of his appeal, that he's cleverly manipulating all of us? I mean, there's so much media here, right? There's almost more media than people.
Costing him a dime, isn't it?
And costing
him
a dime.
Basically.
We had a lot of fun. We got very high grades on that. Even people that hate me gave me good marks. Isn't that amazing?
For the next 20 minutes, he's talking about how he's going to slap tariffs on every country that imports to the United States, and how he's, you know, Ford is going to relocate a factory, and Donald Trump, the president, is not going to allow that. The idea of giving the government that much power over corporate business doesn't seem to trouble this audience at all, which is odd when you think about it. After all those years of propaganda, for years and years and years, what was the party line that we got? Was that free enterprise cures all, the market is self-correcting, we're the best in the world, and we have confidence we're going to do that. Well, that's not what he's saying anymore. People don't have confidence in that anymore. Now they need the strong man to step in and make sure that we all get paid.
I'll bring back our jobs from China, from Mexico, from Japan, from so many places. I'll bring back our jobs, and I'll bring back our money.
Matt Taibbi's acerbic writing on Donald Trump is really reminiscent of I.F. Stone's writing on the demagogue Senator Joe McCarthy and presidents like Ike Eisenhower, John F. Kennedy, Lyndon Johnson, Richard Nixon. Matt is sort of a cross between I.F. Stone and Hunter S. Thompson, the original gonzo journalist who so raucously, viscerally would skewer the powers that were in the early 70s. And as Izzy was drowned out when mainstream media gave Joe McCarthy his megaphone, Taibbi's independent voice can't really compete when mainstream TV news for months provided a fairly uncritical platform and a massive megaphone to Trump.
When do we beat Mexico at the border? They're laughing at us, at our stupidity. They're bringing drugs, they're bringing crime, they're rapists, and some, I assume, are good people.
We spent about a year doing this story, and we found evidence that bodies, human bodies, were buried in, I would say, a criminal way. If we had 200 bodies that were buried in a criminal way in the United States, if they were Anglo, I think that we'd be hearing about it. Because they're Mexican or because they're from south of the border, for the most part, there wasn't any sort of an uproar. The national media didn't pay attention. We found mass graves in the United States. We found people dumped into a mass grave. And they were not cataloged, they were not documented, they were not properly treated. Some individuals were buried in trash bags.
The mainstream media, if we're talking about national media coverage of the migrant deaths in Falfurrias, Texas, to my knowledge, has been non-existent. Media executives, for the most part, people who make decisions on what's on television, are really some of the most ill-informed people when it comes to the news itself. The choices that are made are entertainment-based. Who's pretty? Who speaks English? These are things that I'm asked when I'm pitching a story. They're not going to watch a bunch of bodies being exhumed from a gravesite and seeing law enforcement held accountable. That's not something that's savory. And I'm talking about all of the mainstream media, major networks, ABC, NBC, CBS, PBS. We're being dumbed down. We're being watered down. We're being misinformed. We're being misled. And we're being told information which is false.
I remember pitching a story to 60 Minutes. Which I had done one for about a year prior. And it was about the border, and it was about migrants, stories that rarely see the light of day. And they told me, John, we already did a border story for you. It was a year ago, so there must only be one border story. It's not what their audience wants to see, so they're not interested. Even if it's newsworthy, they're gonna consider the ratings first. Where are they? There are no records of them. They're probably in some cemetery plot somewhere in Texas or Arizona. This is going on all over the border.
My colleagues, we have an obligation to our citizens. We have an obligation to this body to see that our resolutions are complied with. We wrote 1441 to give Iraq one last chance. Iraq is not so far taking that one last chance. We must not shrink from whatever is ahead of us and our responsibility to the citizens of the countries that are represented by this body. Thank you, Mr. President.
Did Colin Powell close the deal today in your mind?
I think for anybody who analyzes the situation, he has closed the deal.
This irrefutable, undeniable, incontrovertible evidence today, Colin Powell
brilliantly delivered that smoking gun today. It was so compelling. I don't see how anybody at this point cannot support this effort.
It was devastating. I mean, and overwhelming, overwhelming abundance of the evidence.
This was the mainstream media's darkest hour. They were more than cheerleaders, they were complicit.
He just flooded the terrain with data.
The Powell speech has moved the ball.
I think case is closed.
You do not, under international law, wage a destructive socicide. They basically blew apart the country because they wanted to get Saddam Hussein. Well, this is like one of the greatest international crimes since World War II.
This is ABC World News Tonight.
This is NBC Nightly News.
This is the CBS Evening News.
And it was committed with the complete complicity of the mainstream media that kept critical voices such as ours off the air.
Well, I think it's important to have experts explain the war and to describe the military hardware, describe the tactics, talk about the strategy behind the conflict. I went to the Pentagon myself several times before the war started, met with important people there and said, for instance, at CNN, here are the generals we're thinking of retaining to advise us on the air and off about the war, and we got right. A big thumbs up on all of them. That was important.
Journalists, too many of them, and some quite explicitly, have said that they see their mission as helping the war effort.
At MSNBC, I was on the air daily as a political and media analyst.
And if you define your mission that way, you'll end up suppressing news that might be important, accurate, but maybe isn't helpful to the war effort.
But I lost my time because they had to make room as we got closer to the invasion of Iraq for this endless parade of retired generals, majors, admirals, former CIA chiefs. And we know now those people had no independence. They were being fed talking points by the Pentagon. And most of what they said as our country was driven to war was false.
Wealthy insurance.
Say that if you're going to question someone.
From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now! Democracy Now! It's slightly larger, I think, than the space I have Stone operated out of, but very much modeled on this idea of the media being a sanctuary of dissent. Now we're broadcasting on over 1,300 radio and television stations, public access TV, community radio, public radio, PBS, public television, but we're not there to win a popularity contest. We're there to bring out the voices of people all over the world.
The problem is most of the big media are businesses. They respond to their investors, the stock market, and their advertisers. And independent journalists bring their conscience to work, and they call the situation as it really is factually. So they're a rare breed. They're not indentured to commercial motivation.
Well, the problem is the illusion of free press. You know, we don't have state media in the United States, but if we had it, how would it be any different? It's easy to criticize Fox. It's Fox, it's CNN, it's the New York Times. That's why we need independent journalism. You know, that's why we need a media that challenges the corporate power. When we cover war, we can't be brought to you by the weapons manufacturers. When we cover climate change, we can't be brought to you by the oil, gas, coal, nuclear companies. When we cover healthcare, we can't be brought to you by the insurance and the drug companies. We have to have a media that is a counterbalance to those in power. It's the only equalizing force.
I think the media is really nihilistic. It's about making money. What makes money in this country happens to be avoiding difficult truths about our society. You know, a story about what it's like to be on welfare, and that's not a story, right? But, you know, Kim Kardashian falls into a puddle in Central Park, that's a story.
Well, Kim and Kanye, also known as Kimye, are expected to get married here in Florence this weekend in a Medici fortress that cost $400,000 to rent out. Erin McLaughlin, CNN, Florence, Italy.
Congresswoman, let me interrupt you just for a moment. We've got some breaking news out of Miami. Stand by, if you will. Right now in Miami, Justin Bieber has been arrested on a number of charges.
So your son served in Iraq?
Yeah, he survived like 3 ambushes, but he came out screwed up. It's,
oh, really?
You know, the PTSD, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, handsome man.
Yeah. How many life has to be destroyed? How many family? Stupid wars, you know? It's like, don't you feel kind of, you know, in danger? Have you been threatened before?
There's dangers, yeah, of working there now. But the risks we take are much less than what other people are doing. So especially people who work in human rights, they have much bigger risks. And so compared to them, you know, you get courage when you see them work. You know, they say, you know, we're engaged in a war on terror, and they use the same language as they use here, war on terror. But the policies just result in more terror. So we have more terrorism now and more war. I started working in journalism right around the beginning of the Iraq War in 2003.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet
you too.
Thanks. It was very frustrating as a young person living here in New York, as an Arab, as someone who was newly politicized and watching this massive invasion being drummed up. One felt like you had to scream and say this is wrong. And there were these kinds of protests. And it was when I first heard Democracy Now! And I first heard these kinds of voices that I hadn't heard at all on other airwaves, voices of dissent, voices of opposition, people who were not allowed on the air. I was very much drawn to this kind of journalism. My first day at Democracy Now! Was the first day of the Iraq War, March 19th, 2003.
Nicholas Kulish, who broke this story. All that and more coming up.
Amy Goodman has nurtured a number of journalists, including Sharif Abdelkaddous. He was a correspondent, a senior producer. He was occasionally a co-host. And then 2011, the uprising begins in Egypt, the country that Sharif was born in. And he flies to Egypt, and the country is almost unrecognizable to him, that the fear was gone. And his vivid reporting had millions of people following his reporting.
It's just after 10 a.m. on Tuesday morning. Today marks the one-week anniversary of the popular uprising that began January 25th. There's more people here than I have ever seen in Tahrir yet in this revolt. Today is the day that they say they're going to get Mubarak out.
For more, we're joined by Sharif Abdelkaddous, who's just returned from Yemen. He's a Democracy Now! Correspondent, a fellow at the Nation Institute, and he's recently written a piece for the Global Post called, With U.S. Help, Saudi Arabia is Obliterating Yemen. It's the first of a two-part series on Yemen. Sharif, start off by just explaining what you found in your weeks-long trip there.
Well, I spent most of the time in the Houthi-controlled north of Yemen, and this is an area that's been pounded relentlessly for the past 9 months with near-daily airstrikes. You can't visit a city or a town in Yemen without seeing the destruction on the ground. Everything has been hit, from homes to schools, restaurants, bridges, roads, a lot of civilian infrastructure. And with that, of course, comes a lot of the suffering. The Saudi bombing campaign is backed by the United States with logistics and intelligence support. And I think that's a fact that many Americans don't realize, that they are complicit with their tax dollars in this conflict that has civilians at the epicenter of its suffering.
Be very careful back there.
I will.
If you had to come up with a slogan for what our new media venture is, the one that Jeremy Scahill and Laura Poitras and I are building under the aegis of First Look Media, you probably could use as a slogan the spirit of I.F. Stone, but funded with $250 million.
Glenn Greenwald has been a lightning rod for controversy since he obtained those secret NSA documents from Ed Snowden and published some of them in The Guardian. Now he's launching a media company backed by wealthy eBay founder Pierre Omidyar.
The main thing is you've got to encapsulate all of this in a way that it can't be decrypted and read when it's in transit across the network or on either of the endpoints.
Okay. I mean, just so you know, these documents are basically all going to be public within 48 hours, 72
this is,
hours,
This
whatever.
Is simply, you know, you want to get in the process of doing this for everything because it seems hard, but it's not hard.
Okay.
This is super easy.
Thank you so much to the Academy. The disclosures that Edward Snowden reveals don't only expose a threat to our privacy, but to our democracy itself. And I share this with Glenn Greenwald and other journalists who are exposing truth. Thank you.
Was Mr. Dawood killed immediately, or did he live for a while after he was shot? You saw the U.S. forces take the bullets out of the body?
When Glenn Greenwald and Jeremy Scahill teamed up together at The Intercept, it was like a dream for adversarial journalists. And since 2014, they've been able, with their team, to break story after story of political corruption, especially scoop after scoop about the national security surveillance state, which mainstream journalists often tend to avoid out of a false notion of patriotism.
Good journalism today has the state in its crosshairs. And you never want to punch down. You always want to punch up. That's what I think we're trying to do at The Intercept.
Mm-hmm. And then once you have that file, just right-click the file in the Finder. Were they able to decrypt it at all?
I don't think so.
I would say our mission statement is to produce adversarial, fearless journalism. The central idea that I think everyone shares is that the more power someone wields, the more journalistic accountability and scrutiny they need.
I mean, it says explicitly there that it's supporting drone surveillance operations.
Most of the bandwidth is on Galaxy 26 and not an NRO secret site.
That must be the satellite. Yeah, it can support up to 40 UAV sorties simultaneously. And these are satellites showing construction of a facility in Germany that the U.S. uses as part of its drone program. The German government basically is trying to argue that it doesn't have any role at all in the targeted killing program, because that would be illegal under German law. It's a story that involves many countries being involved with the U.S. drone program, and their governments either are not aware of it or they're lying. And that's part of what we're trying to nail down. This is the most sophisticated, so-called clean way of bumping people off. I became sort of obsessed with this notion that a man who is a constitutional lawyer by training, who won the Nobel Peace Prize, is presiding over an attempt to legitimize and some would say legalize assassination as a central component of U.S. policy.
I'll make our government open and transparent so that anyone can ensure that our business is the people's business. Justice Louis Brandeis once said, sunlight is the greatest disinfectant.
Who would have thought that we get a president who is a charismatic, perhaps probably one of the smartest presidents, if not the smartest president in U.S. history, with a great background in social justice causes, who would preside over more prosecutions of whistleblowers as spies than all previous administrations combined, who would expand the drone program and try to legitimize the assassination program. When Obama was elected, he pledged that his administration was going to be the most transparent in history.
No more secrecy. That's a commitment I make to you as president. No more secrecy.
You know, we'll work with sources or with documents that we've obtained, and then you try to hunt down the publicly available record on these things. And I mean, an incredible amount of stuff is sort of hidden in plain sight if you dig far enough. I mean, that's all of what I.F. Stone was doing.
In December, Democracy Now! Traveled to the Calais refugee camp, the largest refugee camp in France, about 2 hours north of Paris. 6,000 to 7,000 people are living there, camped out in makeshift tents.
Occasionally people stop to talk, but we've been warned over and over that people don't want their faces shown. They're afraid. They're afraid of being targeted here, and they're afraid their families will be targeted at home. Were there drone strikes?
Yes, there were drone attacks. They're always killing innocent people in the villages. Civilians become very angry, and they join the group of Taliban.
So what do you think the U.S. should be doing now?
You know, U.S. is just increasing the war. Actually, U.S. don't want to finish the war. It's their game. It's the game of George W. Bush, Obama. They don't care about the people who are dying there.
What's very important to explain, and what's systematically lacking in all the accounts that I had come across in the mainstream media, why is this happening? Why are these people where they are? There are policies that have been enacted. There are decisions that have been made. There are bombs that have been dropped, as a consequence of which these millions of people are destitute in the way that they are. And we have to allow them to tell that story.
Do you think the Russian, Syrian, French, British bombing of Syria will save it?
No. It's not the solution. You can't protect someone by killing someone else.
International waters in the Gulf of Tonkin, destroyers of the United States Navy are assigned routine patrols from time to time. Sunday, August the 2nd, 1964, the destroyer Maddox was on such a patrol. Shortly after noon, the calm of the day is broken as general quarters sound. In a deliberate and unprovoked action, three North Vietnam PT boats unleash a torpedo attack against the Maddox.
A classic example of I.F. Stone's ability to ferret out something when no one else was doing it was the Gulf of Tonkin excuse for going into Vietnam. 3 weeks after we had this so-called attack by the North Vietnamese, Izzy read all the after reports, and he said, where is the debris? If we had been hit, why isn't there more being talked about? And he said there were all kinds of excuses why this little tiny country would go against the largest fleet in the world, except the fact that it might have been provoked. All of the media was just following it right into war, as was Congress. And I keep thinking, if the mainstream media had followed Izzy, we might not have had that 10-year disaster.
We haven't been able to get it through our heads that this is a political war. All you have to ask yourself is, why is it that here are Vietnamese on one side, on our side, and here are the same Vietnamese on the other side? Mm-hmm. And on one side, they have very little in the way of arms, they have no air force, no napalm, no big boom-boom, and they really fight magnificently. And on our side, you have five times as many troops, all that equipment, all that firepower, all that artillery, and they're not worth a damn.
A lot of people protested I.F. Stone's being on because, can you imagine, he had the nerve to say things against our war policy.
Why is this?
Why? Because the men on the other side feel they're fighting for freedom. They're fighting for freedom from domination by the white man and by the Westerner.
We need to know what governments do. We need to know what's real, and we need to know what's bullshit. And that's the biggest problem. And Izzy was great at saying, hey, I checked. This is bullshit.
Mrs. Hamblin?
Yes.
Hi, we're from the Washington Post.
I'm Carl Bernstein, this is Bob Woodward.
A friend of the committee said that we could contact you.
I brought no ideological baggage. Whatever my background was to Watergate, I brought a repertorial sense to it, partly because I thought, how could the President of the United States be involved in something this dumb at the beginning?
Two talks.
Okay, so this is the order, and what's circled and not circled.
I think that on the Lloyd Blankfein one, I would end on my tsunami analogy, and it's about the crash on their head.
On their heads,
yeah. Yeah, okay.
IF Stone was onto something really smart with the subscription business. The way you're aligned with your audience is if your audience is paying you. So if you go in the wrong direction, they punish you by saying, I'm leaving and I'm not paying you the subscription anymore. That was true of IF Stone with his newsletter. It's true of our show because we have a subscription model on our website. Hillary Clinton is tired of the Bernie Sanders camp's lies, she says. In fact, here, let me show you. This is when she had a run-in with a Greenpeace activist.
When people make these kinds of claims, which now I think have been debunked, actually the Washington Post said three Pinocchios, the New York Times also analyzed it.
She says that, oh no, it's debunked. Okay, great. I'll go to the source itself that quote unquote debunked the story, Washington Post. Greenpeace tracked nearly $1.5 million in bundled and direct donations from lobbyists currently registered as lobbying for the fossil fuel industry. So that adds up to all the donations to Hillary Clinton, up to more than $4.5 million. So they acknowledge it. They acknowledge it right there, right? But it's still only 2% of the total contributions received by Clinton and outside groups backing her. Now, that's true. But think about that for a second. Their excuse for her is, yeah, I know she took $4.5 million from the oil guys, but she's taken so much more from the others. The bribes that the oil and gas companies gave her are small compared to what the banks gave her. See, not guilty. Bernie Sanders is a liar.
So Elizabeth Warren, that's an interview. I don't think there is even video of that. I think it's Ivy Times. But we do have the panel on Morning Joe and on Hannity.
And also Geraldo.
After the meeting, we had a few videos that we're doing in to just basically get a good round out the story. So 3 years later, some senator says, I never said that. Even if you can't find it somewhere online, I still have it. So I don't get rid of anything. So we have tons and tons of things that I just have saved of what everyone has said ever that we've ever done.
I'm amused at people who claim that the governments don't lie. Really? You know human beings that never lie? Let alone human beings who need to cover their ass and protect their job? Let alone people who need to do all that in public? Of course they lie. Of course they do. When is the last time you heard CNN say the Pentagon is lying? Isn't it amazing that in these decades of CNN's existence, they have never uttered that sentence? So the Pentagon has never lied, according to CNN. Congressman, but overall, I'm a deficit hawk, too. I don't want out of control spending. So then I assume as a deficit hawk, you also want to cut defense spending and you want to raise taxes on the rich, right?
Well, I think the first purpose of this government is to defend the nation. And if we cut defense to the extent that we're no longer safe, let me suggest to you there's nothing that will have a more negative impact on our economy.
19% of the deficit is defense spending, and we spend more on defense than the entire rest of the world combined. But you still think we cannot cut a nickel from there.
We need
every nuke, every sub, every aircraft carrier. Otherwise, we're not going to be able to out-nuke Iran. Is that the logic?
Phil Griffin, who's the head of MSNBC, pulls me into his office. He sits me down and he says, Cenk, I was just in Washington, and they're not happy with your tone. And I sat back in my seat like, oh my God, it's happening. Right? This is like a movie. They're giving me the speech.
You know, some people told me that you were dumb. I think you're smart. In fact, I think you're smart enough to understand a situation when it's explained to you.
And he said, look, I want to be clear with you about this, so just cool it, bring it down a little bit.
Now, if I felt that you had the welfare of the state at heart like I have, I'd say you were a man to watch.
So they would say things like, we need you to act like a senator. I thought, why? Why on God's green earth would you want to act like a senator? Does that mean I should lie more? I should be more fake? People don't like senators. Congress at that point is at an approval rating floating between 7 and 11%. They hate senators. They don't have to tell an anchor coming into the mainstream media, hey, be pro-government, although with me, I was so thick-headed they had to, right? They just don't hire that guy. And if they make the mistake of hiring him, they demote him or they fire him. And then the message is clear in the building. Shh. We don't criticize the powers that be. We don't criticize corporations. We are a giant corporation. We don't take on the establishment. We are the establishment. And the guys who play ball get promotions. And everyone in the building sees them getting promotions. So it is an evolutionary process by which the mainstream media gets the product that it wants.
I think what happened to Cenk Uygur at MSNBC illuminates the process leading to what Noam Chomsky calls manufacturing consent. Corporate news outlets often end up being more propagandistic than journalistic.
Manufacturer of consent makes sure that the ignorant and meddlesome majority keeps out of things. So if they want, for decades, they've wanted national health care, but they don't understand, so keep them out of it. If they want higher taxes on the rich, you know, put them to the side. They don't understand things. They're opposed to wars. It's because they don't understand how important it is for us to bomb Libya, whatever it may be. It used to be in earlier times that you could use force to do this. But by the early 20th century, countries like England and the United States, the more free societies, it was recognized that force was no longer sufficient. So you had to turn to control of attitudes and opinions. It's quite conscious, incidentally.
I think manufacturing consent is essentially the Rosetta Stone for understanding the hieroglyphics of the U.S. media. It is the case that if you go to most media figures and large media corporations and tell them that they're really constrained in the things they can and can't say, and not only will they deny it, but they'll essentially be truthful in their denial in the sense that they believe the denial. But the entire system breeds a certain orthodoxy. It breeds a certain kind of range of pieties. And if you deviate too far from them, it will reject you.
If we don't get to the heart of the fact that there was long ago a coup in this country, a silent coup, where corporations took total control of the process of selecting the leaders in this country, then nothing's going to change.
These are mass graves. They're commingled. Everyone is different. Would you want your son buried that way? Or your mom? Or your sister? Or your brother? I mean, this isn't how you want someone you love to be buried. So this is what we end up with oftentimes. So you can see these are really white because they're sun bleached. So this person was out for a long period of time. And they also sustained quite a bit of carnivore damage.
You know, I'm sort of getting at whether or not there was some sort of a scam with the autopsies. All these reports are missing.
Oh, those are the missing ones. Oh.
So okay. Over 30% of the autopsies ordered.
You don't even have a report for.
We don't even know if they were ever performed. They were billed. I have the canceled checks. I just don't have, if the autopsy was performed, what they found. He had to answer questions for weeks about this. He also was pulled in by some high-ranking local officials in the state and asked very similar questions. So he's had time to prep.
Basically, what happened is Nueces County was providing autopsy services for Brooke County. And they were overwhelmed with Nueces County alone. Of course, I wasn't around when all this was being done. You know, we kind of picked up after the fact, you know.
Some of them were done during the time of your tenure here, too. Some of them were after 2007.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So I'm just wondering, is that the mortuary who's dumping bodies
actually,
in there?
Well, we had, in other words, who monitors the mortuary? They're an independent contractor.
Right.
So in other words, you contract somebody to do it.
You're expecting that
you pay them $750 bucks and they go do the job. All we know is we're going to pay for four.
Right.
500, 500, 500,
right.
And it's going to say one was Eddie Canales, he was identified, this gentleman was John Doe, the other one was another John Doe. In a case where I was not comfortable with cause of death, DNA.
That's the criteria, where you saw something suspicious?
What if you found
just bones or a skull or something?
It's difficult. You can't do that. It would be a waste of time.
You would not order an autopsy if it was just a skull or bones?
No. Yeah. Once a son, 108, 170
So a sun-bleached skull or something, no?
No. It wouldn't. You don't have a problem till somebody makes a problem out of it.
In my investigation, prior to speaking to him, I have found nothing but discrepancies in the paperwork and the documents and the way that records were kept. And he basically, without knowing he did, admitted it all to me. I'm actually just shaking a little bit from it.
I think about I.F. Stone a lot, and I think about his phrase, "all governments lie." And I can show you stack after stack after stack of documents, and I find in our own government documents nothing but lies.
He's come a long way since he was pretty much the original volunteer at Democracy Now!, Jeremy Scahill.
I want to pledge to use this opportunity to educate a new generation of young journalists about the incredibly important work of I.F. Stone.
My hope is that we somehow miraculously produce a generation of young I.F. Stones. We need to stop keeping up with the Kardashians and start going back and catching up on I.F. Stone. Thank you very much.
I think he's really an inspiration in the role that media can play in the world. I think the media can be the greatest force for peace on Earth. Instead, it's wielded as a weapon of war, and that has to be challenged. I.F. Stone taught us governments lie, all governments lie, especially in a time of war. When the media acts as a conveyor belt for the lies, why it matters is because lies take lives. And we see the enormous devastation that came from that we still live with today, so many years later. That came from a media that did not challenge the lies.
There's only two types of reporters. There's those who care, and those who don't. Most of them don't care. But if you care, if you are, as I was in El Salvador, or Gaza, or Sarajevo, then you are immediately branded as political. Because if you care, you can't lie to cover up oppression, atrocity, genocide. And I.F. Stone cared.
The Vietnam War has been a terrible defeat for all the brand names we believe in, for General Electric and General Motors and AT&T, for all the great corporations, all the great industry that do the push buttons. When they turn to war, they know how to kill people en masse. And here down in the jungle, way below, is this strange creature that we can't crush, this strange animal we can't kill. It's time to look closely at it and see. By God, it's a human being. And isn't that wonderful that human beings can resist all this murderous technology of ours?
very briefly and in no small measure to remind ourselves, an observation by Stone on what he thought journalism was all about. In his words, to write the truth, to defend the weak against the strong, to fight for justice, to bring healing perspectives to bear on the terrible hates and fears of mankind, in the hope of someday bringing about a world in which men will enjoy the differences of the human garden instead of killing each other over them. If you look, you'll find much more.